and setting up the times and all that kind of thing. They're going to do a graveside service. And so we'll pass that information along as it becomes available, but certainly continue to remember them in prayer. And I think that's all. All right, let's all stand. We'll start out in a word of prayer. Brother Tracy, would you open us in prayer, please? Amen. All right, let's take your red hymn books, turn over to 296. 296, follow on.
Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere He leads me I would follow, follow on, walking in His footsteps till the crown be won. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus, anywhere, everywhere I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus, everywhere He leads me I would follow on. Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the storms are sweeping and the dark waters flow. With His hand to lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot fright me if my Lord is near. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus, anywhere, everywhere I would follow on. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus, everywhere He leads me I would follow on. Down in the valley or upon the mountain steep, close beside my Savior would my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that He has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God. Follow, follow, I would follow Jesus, anywhere, everywhere I would follow on. Follow, I would follow Jesus, everywhere He leads me I would follow on.
Amen. Turn over to 377. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep o'er the erring ones, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Though they are slighting Him, still He is waiting, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them earnestly, plead with them gently, He will forgive if they only believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feelings lie buried that grace can restore. Touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, chords that are broken will vibrate once more. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Rescue the perishing, duty demands it, strength for thy labor the Lord will provide. Back to the narrow way, patiently wend him, tell the poor wanderer a Savior has died. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Amen. You can be seated and turn over to page 129. 129, Rock of Ages, cleft for me.
Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flow, me of sin the double cure, save from wrath and make me pure. Could my tears forever flow, could my zeal no longer know, these for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. In my hand no price I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes shall close in death, when I rise to worlds unknown, and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Amen. One more. Turn over to 441. 441. Great is thy faithfulness.
They fail not, as thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto pardon for sin and the beast that endureth, thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen.
All right, let's take your Bibles and go to 1 Timothy chapter number 4. 1 Timothy chapter number 4. And whenever you find your place, then let's stand together as we honor the reading of God's word this evening. And we'll go down to verse number 6 to be able to pick up where we left off. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 6. You there, say amen?
Amen.
It says, if thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine, whereunto thou hast attained. But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. For bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having a promise of life that now is, and of that which is to come. This is a faithful saying, and worthy of all acceptation. For therefore we do labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. These things command and teach. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word and conversation, in charity and spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by the prophecy, which with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things, give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine, continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. I want to bring our message this evening of read and apply. Read and apply. Let's pray. Father, once again, we want to thank you so much for this day, for your love, for the blessings that you've extended to us to be able to come back to this evening service. We thank you, Lord, for this great book that we get to study, and we pray, Father, that you would equip us in it. We want to praise you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please do be seated. So we've been able to see some great encouraging words that were given to Timothy, a young preacher going into a church. And remember, Paul already started off. He said there's already some false teaching that's going in there. And so it was going to be kind of a downer for him right at the start to say, well, these are the things that are already happening. And yet he says, think about who he was, using his own testimony, the Apostle Paul, and said, I was injurious. I was a persecutor. I was not who it was that I needed to be, but God made a great difference. And he turned my life around. And then he said, but the spotlight is on Timothy. And he began to share some things about his own life and what it was that was responsibilities that were there. And he started looking at the duties of the church to make sure that it was going forward, because he said, ultimately, this isn't about Paul. It's not about Timothy. It's about the gospel. And it's about the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, it's important. He said, every person needs to be able to hear and understand the gospel message, and that there's one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. And he began to look at the duties of the things that took place in the church and the organization that was there and how it was to be structured. Remember, it was by God's structure. It wasn't for the ideas of man, but it was God that laid all those things out. So it's not just personal preference. You have to check all those things aside and say, we're going to do things the way that God wants. And so he gave out some instructions for pastors, for deacons, for women, for people in general, whenever you're working through the church, to be able to keep things going in the right function for the right matter for Christ. Now, in verse number 6, we take all of that, and he says, if thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ. And remember what he's talking about leading into that in the first part of the chapter. He was saying there are some that are complete apostates. They know what the truth is. They've rejected the truth, and they've started going their own way. They've gone apart from those things. And he says all of that is happening, but he says, but if you'll just go back, if you'll get back to the Word of God, if you'll know what the Word of God has to say, and you'll apply it to in your own life and then share that with others, he said, boy, God's going to be able to use that in a great way there. So if thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ. So the dangers were there. And Paul said, the best thing you could ever do, warn the brethren. Tell them what's going on. Share those things to be able to watch out for. Now, it's interesting to be able to see the importance that's laid on this topic. Now, don't forget, from the physical side, you still got Nero. Nero's in charge about this time as well. Now, of all the physical persecution that could come into a person's life, especially a Christian, Nero is the guy. Absolutely a harmful individual. You read 1st and 2nd Peter, he's addressing that a lot. He said, look, there's a great persecution that is against you personally. But whenever Paul is leaving this lesson to Timothy, he says, you know, the bigger issue that you're going to have to worry about is not the persecution of the body. He said, it's talking about those that are false teachers within the church. He said, that's where you're really going to have to invest your interest. He said, that's where it's going to tear things up. And in fact, whenever you start seeing an outward persecution that comes against the church, it often leads to a strengthening of that body. Amen. Whenever there's some that outwardly they try to persecute from the physical nature, all of a sudden, man, God's people rally together. You can see that when the Apostle Paul was breathing out threatenings and slaughters against the church. Now, there was a dispersion that was there from that church at Jerusalem. But what happened? What happened is those that had been trained in the Word of God went out and they began to teach and preach the Word of God. And all of a sudden, man, the church is just growing. And there's all these little local assemblies that are taken up. And there's the training of the Word of God. And all of these, man, it's just manifesting because of persecution. And so whenever you start looking at the cause of Christ, a lot of times whenever there's a physical persecution that's there, the cause of Christ actually gets stronger. But whenever you start looking at something on the inside, whenever you start looking at a false doctrine, a false teaching, what does it do? It begins to erode away the very foundations of what the church is established on. Before long, if people start falling in with false teaching, it was not classified as a local church at all. It's not just an apostate church. It's not even a church. It's not doing anything that God established his church to be. Man, he's just departed from it, right? Ichabod on it. He doesn't have anything to do with it. And so whenever you start looking at it, the things that cause some of the worst trouble and problems are the inner workings of false doctrine. And that's what it is that Paul is instructing there. He says in verse number 6, he says, man, you got to nourish that church. He says to be nourished up in the words of faith in verse 6, and of good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. You know, we can't go very long without physical food. Amen. You can't go all that long without it. And the same thing is true spiritually. Timothy's going to have to feed them the words of faith and good doctrine. There's got to be that institution of making sure that the faith of the Word of God, the teaching of the Word of God is going to be paramount in every person. He's got to fortify them in truth. So just in case Timothy thought about maybe not giving his best or something like that, Paul reminds him, he says, the strength of the church is going to come by Timothy's study and his faithfulness to the Word to be able to share the things that he's learning and study. So he's going to give instructions for what's going to lead to the very important need and the result of godliness. That's what it's about. Amen? He says there's a church that needs to be a godly assembly. There should be godliness that is prevailing. What is that? Godliness is a matter of holiness in relation to the Word of God. That's what it is. It's holiness in relation to the Word of God. It's not to be confused with religion. Religion and godliness are two different things. Anybody can be religious and they can leave God completely out of it, but they can be religious just in the outward form. It's not about personal goals. It's all about God's will and the alignment of a person's heart with the will of God. So the last portion in chapter 4 is going to give Timothy some instructions that's going to ensure godliness in his ministry. It's one thing to be able to go through like in the previous chapter and say, well, all right, here's the qualifications of a pastor. Here's the qualifications of a deacon. You got to make sure that you're on the up and up on all that. But he says, wait a minute, there is a promotion of godliness, and that's the underlying theme of it all. So it's not enough to just say, all right, you're the husband of one wife. All right, do you do this? All right, do you do that? Okay, you can be the pastor. Remember, there's also the desire that we started off in the very beginning with, amen? And the ultimate desire is that of godliness. It's the desire to be able to grow the things of God. And to be honest, we can all be deceived by apostates and false doctrine and things of that nature if we're not staying attentive and true to the Word of God. That's why it's so very important that we're always in God's Word, not just kind of here and there. Well, I was in church for a while, skipped last month, you know, and here I came back for a minute and, you know, and all that kind of thing. Man, we got to get saturated in the things of God, the teaching of the Word of God. It has to be something that is paramount. So first thing I want you to notice is he calls for an exercise to godliness, an exercise to godliness. Look at verse number 7. He says, but refuse profane and old wives' fables and exercise yourself rather unto godliness. So there are some things that Timothy is going to have to refuse. He's going to have to stay away from things that don't really matter. There's plenty of things that are frivolous. There's plenty of things that are speculations, and he calls them fables. What is a fable? It's a story that's kind of been cooked up. It probably had some little tidbit of truth in the beginning, but then it just kind of keeps fostering. I mean, it just kind of keeps festering up into something that all of a sudden there's no truth in it whatsoever. And Paul calls them, he says, old wives' fables. Old wives, and I was wondering, I said, what does that mean? That's got to have some spiritual meaning. It doesn't. Here's what it means. It means whenever old ladies sit around and talk about things that are foolish or silly, that's what it means. Literally, that's it. It's things that are unbiblical. It's things that all of a sudden there's no picture of godliness that is in their conversation at all. You know, the elder ladies are supposed to have a key role in godliness in a church. Everybody say amen right there. Now, turn over about five pages to your right to the book of Titus. Titus chapter number 2, and we're going to see that real quick. Titus chapter number 2 and verse number 3. He says, the aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, and the word of God is not blasphemed. There is such a great responsibility whenever you're looking at those, whenever it's talking about an elder lady in the church. There's a huge responsibility. Man, that's a need, amen. There's a need for those that have been trained up in the Word of God and learned what it means to be able to have the Word of God in practice in your home and your life and everybody that's around, and then take somebody that is untrained in that, that's young in the faith, and to be able to come alongside and say, let me tell you what the Bible says about you as far as a keeper of the home. Let me tell you how it is that you're supposed to reverence your husband. Let me tell you how it is that you're supposed to honor God in all things. There's a responsibility in that, and it's very necessary. But Paul's telling Timothy, he says, on the other side, it can be just a bunch of old wives' fables that you get roped into. It could be a lot of foolish talk that's not leading to any kind of spiritual prosperity at all. And by the way, foolish talk can happen at any age and either gender. Amen. So it doesn't really matter where it's coming from. The point is we need to make sure that we don't get roped up in those things. Timothy was going to have to separate himself from the talk that's going on at the coffee shop and the conspiracy theories of the day. Again, you know, in our day, hey, there's a lot of conspiracy theories that are out there. Amen. Some people think the earth is still flat. Literally. Now, I know they're a little nutty. You know, a lot of times, though, those conspiracy theories, they're the same way as the old wives' fables. They probably started off, there's a little bit of truth in there. There's a little bit of things that are pretty much right on. A lot of those things that we're looking at, so that was a conspiracy theory in the 70s, came out it was right. Amen? Man, there's a lot of things that happened. But here's the deal. If a preacher, if Timothy, if a Christian is going to get mixed up in all that, he's not going to be faithful to the Word of God. See, that's where the big discerning thing is happening. Yeah, there may be some truth in it, but look, I got a whole book of truth right here. Amen. Listen, if I want to invest my life, how about it being in truth? And that's what happens a lot of times with a conspiracy type of thought. There may be one thing that is spot on. There may be 50 other things that have no relevance to truth whatsoever. And the problem is you don't have really the luxury of sitting back and saying what is legitimate and what was thought up by some guy that's still in his pajamas in his parents' basement. Amen. You can make anything sound like it's going to be right. But again, you have to go back and say, wait a minute, what's truth? And Paul is telling Timothy, listen, you got a whole church that's going to be depending upon you. You got a whole group. They're already under the attack of false doctrine. You've already got apostates that are working. Man, get off of all that. Get settled in truth. That's what they need. People need truth. Think about it. My job is to study the Word of God. A lot of those things true? Probably. We'll find out, won't we? But none of it's really going to matter. There's a lot of things that we call a conspiracy theory and say, it is spot on right. Okay. Does it help me by knowing it's right? No. Does it help me by knowing the Word of God? Every single day. Yes. Every single minute. So he's saying, look, there's going to be some things that you're going to have to invest in. And there's a whole world of people that are without Christ that can get roped into godless speculation. We have the gospel. We have the Word of God, the Word of truth. Likewise, there's this amazing number of people that get wrapped up in trying to argue against some oddball cult. Hey, man. Man, all of a sudden, man, they invest all of their time. Well, did you know what the new cult is saying? I don't really know. I don't really need to care. Hey, man, they're coming up all the time. What's a cult? It's just somebody that takes the same thing. It's a little bit of truth, and then they depart from it, and they add in their own stuff. Get back to truth. Amen. So Paul's telling Timothy, he says, refuse the fables. What does that mean? He says, Timothy, you're going to have to learn the favorite word is no. No. You're not going to get wrapped up in those things. He's going to have to not get pulled into fantasy land because of the good of the congregation is at stake. The good of the gospel message is at stake. You can't let that fall through the cracks for some other pursuit. That's true of every member of a local church. You have an influence on those in the body. And instead of dragging somebody down this rabbit hole, man, bring somebody up to godliness. Amen. Pull somebody along to the truth. That's what they need. Now look at verse number 7. It says, but refuse profane and old wives' fables and exercise thyself rather unto godliness. That word exercise, it comes from the word gymnazo. Gymnazo. Like saying that. Tonight, you're going to remember that. You'll say that. Gymnazo. It's where we get our word gymnasium. It's talking about to exercise. It means you're going to have to invest in training. It's talking about that working out. It means work out those spiritual matters according to Scripture so that godliness is the result personally as well as through the assembly. It's not going to just fall into your lap. You're going to have to work at it. Amen? Just like anybody else that goes to the gym. If you go to the gym and you just kind of sit there and watch other people, you're not going to benefit from it. Amen? You got to get in there. You got to get working on it. Now look at verse number 8. He says, bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of that life that now is, and of that which is to come. Now, he says, it profiteth little. That means there is a benefit to bodily exercise. Amen. We cannot discount those things. There is a benefit to that. You need to be in good shape. You need to maintain your health. Why? Because you're going to have longer to be able to tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. If our immune system was probably in better shape, the whole COVID thing wouldn't even be an issue. Somebody would have had a cold and been like, oh, well, that's all it is. You know, nobody ever tells you, take a lot of vitamin C. Just, you know, build up your immune system. You know, but there's a need for those things. But the benefit of any physical exercise, it's far exceeded by the benefit of your spiritual exercise. How much that you work out and get established in the Word of God. It's profitable unto all things. You have to keep your spiritual life in perspective. Spiritual growth is going to benefit you now, and then, man, there's eternal rewards to come. Amen? It helps you on the day by day. You don't even have to say, well, one day in heaven, I'll be glad that I memorized that verse. You'll be glad you memorized it now. You'll be glad that you know the Word of God now. Man, this is the textbook for life right here. It's good to be able to understand what it is that God has left for us. You know, if more people know their Bible, if people have that right, if we got the mind of Christ, think about what it does. It's going to change your whole understanding of things like a work ethic. You know, there wouldn't be riots and protests if people just knew their Bible. Amen. Things like honoring God, morality, family. Man, all of those things, it's in the Word of God. What about the home? People are confused about racism. You know, the Bible addresses all of that. It's there. And to mention, not to mention identifying the false teaching that starts eroding away the foundations. It's all in the Word of God. Amen. Yeah. Why do we study through books of the Bible? I don't even like 1 Timothy. I think that's the preachers. I shouldn't be here. Listen, that's the mentality that allows false doctrine into a church where nobody knows what's going on. God gave us all of Scripture for us to be able to grow thereby. It's necessary. He said, godliness is to be the purpose and the reason for ministry. Look at verse number 9. He says, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation. He says, this is faithful and accepted, worthy of, accept all of it. Amen? It's all for you. Number 2, he gives an exhortation to teach. An exhortation to teach. And look at verse 10 and 11. It says, for therefore we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. these things command and teach. Now, this is kind of a side note, but let's look at that real quick where he says, especially of those that believe. All right? That sounds kind of funny, doesn't it? He's like, well, he's the Savior of all men, especially those that believe. What's he talking about? He's talking about a defining point that's there. So in one, the Lord Jesus Christ is the potential Savior of all men. Amen? All men. If a person is going to be saved, it's going to be because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every person has that potential. He is the potential Savior of all men, but He is the actual Savior of all those who believe. Amen? So just because I know that Jesus is the Savior doesn't matter until I receive Him personally. And that's what he's talking about in that. And then he says, verse 11 there, these things command and teach. Now, if you notice in verse number 10, he says, there's going to be labor, and there's that suffer reproach. And we understand labor. Labor, it means that energy and effort is going to be used for the glory of God. And with all that labor to understand and study and rightly divide, it won't always be met with appreciation and applause. Paul's telling Timothy, he says, listen, remember, you got all the false teachers there. They're probably not going to like it whenever you go in there and start preaching truth. They're going to be taken aback a little bit. He says, sometimes there's going to be some that are going to be very excited about it because, hey, finally, truth. But he said, there's others that are going to bring about reproach. He said, you're going to have to go through some reproach. People may ridicule or mock or curse Timothy. He may be persecuted. Paul understood something about that. Paul's not telling me, he says, listen, I was persecuted a lot, but you probably never will be. No, if he's going to stand for truth, he's probably going to get some of the same medicine. Amen. Now, why is that? Because God is still a living God. Listen, that's what brings it about. Jesus said in John 15 and verse 20, he says, remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you if you have kept my saying and keep yours also. He says, if you stick to the word of God, there's going to be persecution. If they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. Paul says the same thing. He says, man, if they were persecuting me and you're standing for the exact same thing, if you're standing for truth, you know, there's probably going to be some persecution on your end as well. He said, don't be surprised whenever there's reproach that's there. And by the way, there's no time limit on that promise of reproach. Doesn't mean that, well, that expired. You know, we don't have to worry about that anymore. No, all you have to do is stand for the Lord Jesus Christ in your workplace. You'll probably understand something about reproach. I don't mean where he's like, well, I just try to let my light shine and, you know, I don't use profanity and I'm always kind and I'm always smiling. No, wait a minute. Speak for the Lord Jesus Christ. Start standing up for Christ. There may be some persecution that comes whenever you say, this is what the Word of God says and this is what I believe and this is what I'm going to do. There's probably going to be some reproach that comes by those things. But because we have truth, the minister is to labor and share the gospel regardless of the reproach. And whenever one person receives Christ, what does that mean? It's worth it all. Amen. Listen, as much reproach as Timothy would ever have to endure, as much bad press as he's going to get for standing for truth, as much heartache as he's going to get, and maybe physical punishment that he gets for the one person that says, I know Jesus is my personal Savior. He said, oh, it's worth it all. Just keep standing for God. Verse 11, he says, these things command and teach. What does that mean? It means there's going to be some preaching and some teaching there as well. He's to preach and teach with the authority from God. That's why God has called a preacher. That's the reason that it's called preaching. What is preaching? It's proclaiming the Word of God with power and authority. That's what it is. You can't confuse preaching and teaching. You can't confuse the two. Now, what's the difference? Teaching means that it's all teaching. Preaching is, there's preaching that's there, but there's also going to be teaching with the preaching. Amen? So if you got preaching, there's proclaiming with power and authority, but there's also teaching that's going on. Teaching, a person can teach and never preach at all. And what he's saying here is, hey, preaching is, you make that the top. Priority. That's the word. Thanks. I knew it was a P word. It's like hangman. All right. Somebody give me an R. Amen. So make that the priority. It's the priority. And if preaching is done right, then all of a sudden there's the teaching that's coming along with that as well. You're getting that understanding. Now, and think about what Paul's having to tell Timothy about this. It's not a popularity contest. Amen? And it's not always a feel-good moment, but it is always the will of God for him to do just that. And God will certainly deliver him through those times of reproach, all the days of unknown, and the things that he doesn't understand. God will take care of that. That's God's part. And one of the things that I've learned to really be able to take comfort in is that God always has a message to share. God always has a message to share. It took me a long time to figure that one out. I had too much me. Whenever I started preaching, there was too much where I thought, I've got to make the message and I've got to put all this together and I got to make it sound good. It's not about me at all. And whenever I figured that out, that was good. That was real good. Because I'd like to be able to say to one of those pastors, well, I've got the next four months of messages already on file and they're ready to go. They're not. I'll go ahead and ruin it for you. I usually don't know what I'm preaching next Sunday. I don't have any idea. And it used to be the time where, Thursday evening, Friday morning, if I still didn't know, man, you know how many years I sweat off my life? I don't know what we're going to get up and do something. Hangman, I don't know. But then, through all the years, I found out God has never stopped. God has never not given a message. Now, usually what happens, and I have learned some important things, like when you read, have a pencil. Amen. Paper, where I've been, because there's been too many times where I was like, oh, I was just reading about that. I wonder where it was. I don't remember. Been too many places, and I have to, it's easier just to jot it down. Oh, here's a note or something. But I've seen it too many times where at the end of the week, all of a sudden, man, it may be on Saturday morning, all of a sudden God gives me a good illustration. That was it. Man, that's what tied the whole thing together. I didn't even know where we were going with this. And man, all of a sudden it hits. And you just look and say, wait a minute, it's because it's God's work. Man, he's the one in control. He's the one in charge. And all of a sudden, he gives me a little bit of comfort to know, as long as I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, as long as I'm pursuing godliness, as long as I'm living for the Lord, as long as I'm putting his word where it's supposed to be, as he's the priority, paramount, that's the word I was looking for. That was it. That's priority works, though. As long as that's first, man, God takes care of it. It's his work. Man, God is so good to be able to meet every single need. Man, he's equipping every message. Every time that you come into the house of God, I hope you come with an expectation that you're going to hear from God. Amen. I hope, if anything else, get this. I don't have this year's Christmas message already together. Whenever you come, God's going to do that. Next Sunday when we meet, I don't have it all lined out. God's going to do that. Man, God's got something for us every single day. Man, remember, we just saying his mercies are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. God is so faithful to be able to give what we need. Give us this day our daily bread. We're not storing something up for 6 months from now. I need something today. Man, God is faithful to be able to give everything that's needed. And that's God's work. And that's what Paul's telling Timothy. He says, you look at God's work. What is it? It's encouraging. It's edifying. It's equipping the saints with what it is that God has given in truth. Third, he says, be an example to others. Be an example. Look at verse number 12. He says, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. He says, be an example. Now, Timothy was a young man. And it was probable there was going to be some people that didn't really want to hear those commands and measures and teaching and all that kind of thing from somebody that was younger than them. That word despise there is let no man despise thy youth. Despise doesn't mean they're going to hate him. I mean, they're going to hate you because you're young. It doesn't mean that at all. What it means is they're going to slight him. He says, don't let anybody slight you. Don't let anybody think that the words that you say are not important because your age doesn't measure up to their thought. They wouldn't, there's a potential they wouldn't give the word of God the credence that it needs simply because Timothy was a young man. Age is a very subjective thing, isn't it? Amen. We could poll the crowd and we could probably say, I used to think 40 was ancient. I think it's a drop in the bucket today, amen, right on. And we could ask somebody else and say, man, you don't know anything. Whippersnapper, And, there's all these different ideas. And that's true for vocations. If you're in professional sports, late 30s, you're getting ready to retire. I mean, you're just about done. You know, everything's already pretty well broke down. You know, you've already had your hips and knees replaced. Who was the, there was the gymnast we were, what's her name? Mary Lou. Yeah. What is she like? You know, she's our age. I don't know. But anyway, she's already had double hip replacements twice. All the, I mean, all these type of things. It just kind of wears you out. On the other side, think about the president of the United States. You know, if you're going to be president, usually 60s and 70s. By the time the people are saying, man, I need to retire and take it easy, they're like, I want to be the president of the United States. Not me, man. So there's a lot of different speculation and different things whenever we think about sports. Mike Tyson's coming out of retirement. Him and Roy Jones Jr., they're going to have a, they're 54. You know, I remember as a kid, I'll share just a quick story. I used to watch boxing. And so I remember having that thought whenever Mike Tyson was in his prime. Because this is whenever, you know, it's like, oh, $1 million to get in the ring. And I would play that through like I'd have a chance. I was like, I wonder if I would get in the ring with Mike Tyson for $1 million. I mean, it's going to be over in 4 seconds. I mean, if I could run to the other side that long, probably not. But overwhelmingly, I thought, that ain't worth it. No, he ain't hitting me. He would have to catch me first, trip me, because I'm going to be, pow, man, I'm going to be making a streak. And so, anyway, whenever I saw that he was coming out of retirement, I thought about it again. Hey, he's 54. Not a chance. If I could be my 20-year-old guy going in with 54, no. Not a prayer. I ain't the guy. There's not a dollar that's worth it for me. No way. But you think about all this. Man, age is so, there's all these different thoughts about it. You know, for a preacher, the element of interest is not in the year. It's not a matter of saying, oh, okay, I'll listen to a preacher as long as he's 52 and up. No, it's how much maturity is there spiritually? How many years has been invested in the Word of God? Has God called him? If so, then is he representing God? Shouldn't I get past the age issue or the thoughts about any mannerism that a preacher has just to be able to say, I want to know the Word of God? Because God is equipping him to do that very thing. And everybody's a little bit different. Paul assures Timothy that God's going to take care of that little misrepresentation that he's probably going to have to deal with. Timothy's job was not to try to appease. It was not to try to cater to somebody else. He says, your whole job, he said, be an example. You're carrying the Word of God. You're teaching the truth. But then give them the example that they need. He says, be an example in word is the first thing he says, verse 12. You know, he probably said that one first because that's going to be the hardest. That means in the words that he says, and how it is that it's being said. Man, it's going to be a difficult thing for him. He says, but be an example in word. Be an example, secondly, in conversation. Conversation is talking about your manner of life. It's your lifestyle. His conduct was to be disciplined and controlled. His manner of life was to illustrate that he was a true follower of the Lord. His lifestyle was supposed to represent that. He was supposed to be a billboard for the gospel. Hey, man. And can I tell you, if you're saying, oh, this is for preachers, this is for every child of God. Amen. We're supposed to be a billboard for the gospel. He's supposed to give the example in charity. What does that mean? It means you're going to minister in love. That's going to be a proponent of the ministry going forth. You're going to have to be an example in spirit. He was going to have to be led by the Holy Spirit and keep his attention on spiritual things. There's supposed to be a Christ-mindedness. He's going to always be thinking about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's always to be thinking about what would God have me to do in this? How would God use this? What's this illustration that God, why is God bringing me to this? How can I help this person? It's all that part of that ministry. And in faith, Timothy was to be faithful to the responsibility in ministry. He was to be loyal to the Lord, regardless of whether it's a hardship or a great opportunity or whatever the case. You know, there's a lot of preachers right now today, this Sunday, they're being very tested on faithfulness. I mentioned this in Sunday school, maybe in Sunday morning, I don't remember. But you got places where municipalities are shutting off the power and the water to churches that meet together, and not just at church buildings, but if they speculate that there is a meeting of Christians that's going on at a house, they're cutting off the utilities to the people's house to be able to stop them from gathering together. That faithfulness is being tested. You know, that's the one thing that a steward is commanded to do. It's required in stewards that a man be found faithful. That's it. Man, all of a sudden, we just got to be faithful. We've got to do what God says to do. He says, be an example in purity. He was to live a life where the standards are not set by the world. Now, again, we've already talked about that. It doesn't mean that a preacher's perfect, but he is supposed to be spiritually mature and growing. There is supposed to be a purity in heart and his desires. We've already seen the details of these things in the lives of pastors and deacons, but every Christian should be a living example, every single one of us. So, well, how long have I got to do that? Is this Sunday morning and Sunday evening? Now, look at it, verse number 13, he tells us. He says, look at those first three words, till I come, till I come. Now, think about it. We don't even know if Paul ever came. We don't know for sure. Did Paul ever come to where Timothy was? We don't know. Did he die first? You know, Timothy came to him, but did he go there? You know, our responsibility to be able to live for the Lord, it's not based on whenever Paul comes, it's whenever Jesus comes. Amen. So until he comes, till the Lord comes, we're to continue. What are we supposed to do? Keep growing. Look at verse number 13. It says, till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. It says, keep growing. Give attendance to the reading. Stay in the Bible. You know, and the Bible is great because you never get to the last verse. You never do. You never go and say, that's it. Never have to read the book again. Now you get to the end, you're like, you know, I just remembered something. And you go back and you start reading that thing through again. You never get to the end. There's always something else. You're always starting over. You always have more to gain. I don't know the number of times where I've listened to a preacher stand up and read a passage. I've never seen that word before. I didn't even know that word was there. Now I'm doing a word study on, you know, on all the times that word's been used. There's always something else, always something that you're growing and learning of the Word of God. Can I tell you, with the Bible, you can't read it too slow. And I'll say, you can't read it too fast. You say, oh, yes, you can. You can read so much you don't even know what you read. I promise you, whenever you're reading the Word of God, it's amazing. You can blow through. Man, you can read. And I've done this, and I encourage you to do it. Pretty fun, because I proved myself wrong. As I used to be on that board where I'd say, well, if you don't read it slow, you're not getting anything at all. You need to slow down and meditate. And there's a call for that. But on the other hand, I've gone through and I said, all right, I'm just going to read it. Man, I'm going to see how fast I can read through the Bible. Did I miss a lot? Yep, sure did. Did I gain a lot? Sure did. You know, it's amazing whenever you cover about 8 or 10 chapters at a sitting, how much you start picking out little phrases that keep coming up. Man, I never saw that before. Now, if I was on this phrase and it was 6 months before I got to the next phrase, I forgot it. My brain doesn't retain quite like that. But whenever you see it time and time again, all of a sudden you start saying, wait a minute, man, I see a whole theme that's developing in the Word of God. How awesome is that? So I don't care if you're reading it fast, if you're reading it slow, you know, the only way you're going to lose is if you don't read it. That's it. Man, get in that Bible. As you read, guess what? That's not the end either. He says you keep reading, but on the other side he says keep ministering. He says in verse 13, he says, give attendance to the exhortation and to doctrine. Keep encouraging the saints with the Word of God. He says, hey, read that thing and start to apply it and then teach it to somebody else. Keep sharing what you learn in Scripture. It's the Bible that directs and comforts and encourages. It's the Bible that helps people in the day-to-day. It's the Bible that you need. Man, it's the Word of God. It's the Word of truth that's going to encourage you to say, you know what? I can make this week. You may get to the point where you say, I don't think I can make another week. You get into the Word of God, you can. You'll find something. You'll be excited to call up and say, I just read this. Have you ever read this before? Greatest thing ever. Man, all of a sudden you're encouraged just in the way that you share the Word of God. With all of the instruction, he goes on to say, he says, listen, don't start with everybody else. Don't start with the thought that you got to go fix everybody else. He says, start with you. Now look at what he says. Here it is, verse 14. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which has given thee by the prophecy and with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. He says, start with you. You know, Timothy could do the same as all the rest of us. He could get to the point where he could just say, man, I'm just tired. I don't think I can handle it. I think Paul knew that Timothy was going to need a little poking every now and then. Amen? Any of y'all ever need a poking? I mean, Paul needed it. You remember on the road to Damascus? He says, it's hard for thee to kick against the what? The bricks. What is that? That was that goad he was talking about. Remember, you got your oxen there, and you got the little goad to keep the oxen going. You get a couple of thousand pounds of beef standing there in front of you. Don't want to go? Oh, yeah, a little sharp stick in the back of the leg. That'll do it. And then that next leg, poke him again. They try to kick against it. Man, they're kicking that little sharp spike. That's what God says. Hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Hard to kick whenever you got the Lord goading you along. And Paul says, guess what, Timothy? Oh, I'm going to goad you just a little bit. I'm going to just kind of poke you a little bit in the back of the leg. I'm going to move you forward. And he says, even after I'm dead, God will do that for you. Man, the Lord is so good to just kind of poke you along. Right. Just keep moving forward. So notice what he says. Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by the prophecy with the laying on of hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them. For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. God equips us with all the spiritual gifts for the good of all. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse number 7, it says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man. That means the spiritual gifts that you've given are given to every man to profit with all. It's for the benefit of the whole. They're given for the perfecting of the saints, the work of the ministry, the edifying of the body of Christ. And God says, I equip you with all these things to keep the whole thing moving forward. So Paul, he's reminding Timothy of the ceremony, the confidence. He says, the laying on of hands by the presbytery. He said, you remember that spiritual gift of prophecy? What is that? The preaching, that gift of preaching that I've given you, the confidence that's there. Those that have invested their time, the one that laid hands on you says, hey, I know you're going to go far. I know you got stuff to do. I know that you're going to be faithful to God. He's just encouraging him in those things. Timothy was going to have to meditate on it. He was going to have some times where he's going to have to say, you know what? Let me see where God's brought me. Let me see what God's been doing. And God started me off as a child learning the scriptures. Man, I've been growing in the scriptures all this time. And then all of a sudden, here comes the Apostle Paul. He gets saved. Then he starts following Paul around. Then Paul is investing in his life. And then all of a sudden, here comes the presbytery. Here comes these that are laying hands on him. Says, oh, man, God has given you a gift. You're going to be preaching. You're going to be. And he says, all of this has been invested in me. And he says, that's what it's going to take for him to continue to mature in Christ. He said, don't forsake that. Don't get away from everything that God has established and what he started. Man, keep going and keep maturing in the Word of God. There's enough immature believers. The need is for us to honor God with all of our life. He says, give yourself wholly to it. That's what he says in verse number 15. Give thyself wholly to them. You don't have to be a preacher to take that advice. Amen. Give yourself wholly to the things of God. It's for every believer. And get this, it's never too late to start. Never too late. Always make sure that you're honoring God every day. It's for Him. Let's all stand. We'll have a word of prayer. Father, we want to thank you so much for today. Thank you for the gifts that you give. Thank you for the way that you equip us. Thank you for the truth of your word, Lord, and for the example that you give us through Timothy and the instruction that you give him through the Apostle Paul. Lord, I want to thank you for the way that you desire your word to be able to go forth. And I thank you, Lord, for this great number of Heritage Baptist Church that want to see the same thing. So I pray, God, that you would help us, Lord, to honor you in all things, to be able to put you first, and, Lord, to be able to see the importance that's given for sound doctrine, and, Lord, the desires that we have to be able to honor you. I pray, God, that you would help us to be able to stay strong and true. And Lord, I pray if there's one here that's been struggling with a decision, if there's a decision to receive Christ as Savior, I pray, God, that you would give them that strength to be able to come forward at this time. And Lord, if there's maybe we've been struggling with the things of the world, but we need you, Lord, I pray, Father, that you would give us a great victory tonight. Father, it may be that we just need to be able to come and pray and ask your direction and your guidance, your hand, Lord, to be upon us over this coming week so that we not falter and fail, but we would stay true in our livelihood and our character, our speech, all these things, the purity of our life. Lord, I pray, Father, that we would commit this time invitation to you. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. We're going to sing page 306 this evening of Have Thine Own Way. We'll sing through a couple of verses. You need to come and pray. Why don't you come at this time? 306. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Wounded and weary, help me, I pray. Power, all power, surely is thine. Touch me and heal me, Savior divine. Sing that last verse. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with thy spirit till all shall see Christ only always living in me. Amen. That's a great thought, isn't it? Till all shall see Christ only, always living in me. Boy, that's exactly what it was that Paul was telling Timothy. Amen. True for every single one of us. Let's be closed out in a word of prayer. I hope you have a wonderful week. Remember to be praying for our church family, those that are going through loss and difficult times right now. And just continue to pray and lift them up. Brother Josh Trahan, would you dismiss us in prayer, please?